here's tonight's headline. Boot and rally. After booting U.S. troops from northern Syria, leaving our Kurdish allies to fend for themselves after a Turkish invasion, President Trump did what he always does when facing a bad news cycle. He rallies. It wasn't just the bipartisan fallout from Trump's inexplicable Syria blunder, creating bad headlines for the president. There were also a handful of court defeats, the resignation of his acting Homeland Security chief, damning testimony from his ousted Ukraine ambassador. Nothing a good old-fashioned hootenanny can't solve. Trump let all his rage out at the second of two rallies in as many days, warning the president's about to use foul language, so you might want to earmuff your kids.
The radical Democrats' policies are crazy, their politicians are corrupt, their candidates are terrible, and they know they can't win on election day, so they're pursuing an illegal, invalid, and unconstitutional bullshit impeachment.
If he sounds Nixonian, it's because things are getting downright Watergate-y. Multiple arrests, leaked text messages, alarm bells from inside the White House, and more to come next week. The House will hear from Trump's former Russia advisor, his deputy assistant secretary of state, the counselor of State Department, and perhaps most significantly, ambassador to the EU, Gordon Sondland, he of the infamous call me text. But much like Nixon, Trump is doing his best to obstruct all that, taking the unprecedented step of freezing out a co-equal branch of government in a temper tantrum letter to Speaker Pelosi, basically saying, with no legal footing, that the White House will not be complying with congressional subpoena power. When it comes to Congress and the separation of powers, Trump is not a fan. Congress, in his view, is meddlesome, annoying, and, well, it just gets in the way. Recall, after a Republican-controlled Congress, he hates those too, refused to appropriate funds for his border wall, he said, screw it, I'll just take the money they already approved for the military and reroute it to the wall. Yesterday, a federal judge in Texas ruled that that move was unlawful. Trump went around Congress to sell $8 billion in arms to Saudi Arabia after Congress voted against it, exploiting a loophole in federal law. He threatened to strike Iran without congressional approval. The House passed legislation barring him from doing that, but it went on to die in the Senate. And then, of course, there's the blatant rejection of Congress's constitutional authority that got us here, the Ukraine aid, the reason we're talking about all of this. Trump put a hold on funds approved for Ukraine by a bipartisan Congress, funds that were greenlit by State Department officials, and he never gave a reason for delaying those funds. Of course, a transcript of a phone call with the president of Ukraine, during which our president, as for a favor, has given lots of sane people an idea. Okay, here's the deal. Trump has gotten away with bypassing Congress and ignoring our separation of powers, and that's because Republicans have largely let him. Congress is supposed to be a check on the executive. It's supposed to have the power of the purse, and it's supposed to require permission for the authorization of military force. And on nearly every count, Trump has essentially said to Congress, you people are irrelevant. Promising elected lawmakers now that he will stonewall their investigation, telling subpoenaed witnesses not to testify or cooperate, he'll keep doing it as long as he knows he'll get away with it. But when will Republican members of Congress, elected to be a check on the executive, to control the purse, and to play a leading role in matters of war, when will they decide to take their jobs back? We'll wait here. Congress returns this week. Here to talk about what they'll do about Trump's obstruction is Democratic Congresswoman Debbie Dingell. Congresswoman, you've been saying we need to let this process play out, follow the facts. How do you do that, though, when the White House is stonewalling?
So, good evening, SE. It's good to talk to you. The fact of the matter is that one of the reasons that I was reluctant this summer to come out was because how divided this country is. And the point at which I came out was when a whistleblower had filed a complaint, a President Trump inspector general had found that the complaint was credible, urgent, and of danger to our national security. We have to be very transparent about this as this is happening, and we have to make sure that the American people understand why we're doing it. They can't believe that we're throwing the kitchen sink at them or that this is a witch hunt. They have to understand, like we do, that the rule of law is the glue that holds us together as a nation, that nobody's above the law, that my job, when I take that oath of office, is to protect our democracy and our Constitution, and that's what we're doing right now, following the facts, getting the facts. And by the way, we got lots of speculation. We still don't have all the facts.
Right. So do you believe that Trump stonewalling and trying to keep you from getting all of the facts, do you think that amounts to obstruction?
I think it doesn't help. I think that he is looking and asking for a contempt of Congress, though you're seeing some of the witnesses come forward after they are subpoenaed. I keep going back to when I was young, and I really was in high school, early college, working for Senator Robert Griffin, a Republican senator from Michigan. And I flew back with him the day that he called Richard Nixon and told him that he needed to resign. And up until that moment, he had been with him. I was lucky enough, my family knew President Ford. I remembered what it was like back then. Mm-hmm. And suddenly, they heard the tapes, and they knew that he had lied. And I think that that's why getting the facts right now, being slow, deliberative, making sure that we're getting them and that people under, we do have to worry about our national security. I'm someone that thinks a classified setting is probably the appropriate place for some of these briefings. But what can be made public should be made public. And, you know, I want to get back and talk to my colleagues, Republican and Democrats, because, by the way, this shouldn't be partisan. This is about us as Americans, and we're fighting for our American democracy. We all need to be looking at this as Americans, not partisans.
So Speaker Pelosi had a call with the caucus yesterday. What did she say about next steps or strategies?
You know, I think the speaker has tried very hard. We've been home for 2 weeks while the committees have been doing the work that they had to do because of the Jewish holidays. She has kept people abreast, the three committee chairmen that have been, Chairman Schiff, who's been doing these classified briefings, but assisted by Chairman Engel and Chairman Cummings, have been talking about the work that's been done. She, too, is being very deliberative and very, she wants people to know what's happening, talking about the other issues. Yesterday, there was some discussion of Syria. But when we get back next week, Chairman Schiff stepped out of the hearing and was still hearing from the witness yesterday just to make sure that he was talking to his colleagues. But I think all of them are still in the data collection process, concerned by what they're hearing, concerned by this refusing to talk to us. These are three equal branches of government. The president can keep trying to blow us off, but that's not how our Constitution's written.
Well, I know you want to be deliberative, and Nancy Pelosi wants to be deliberative. The committees want to be deliberative, but Nancy Pelosi also does not want this to drag on.
It can't.
Forever. And so how do you balance the need to get all the facts where Trump is stonewalling, but also not wanting this to carry on through to the election?
Well, I think he himself is going to decide part of if the White House refuses to cooperate. You're seeing subpoenas. Some people are choosing to come forward voluntarily. I think the next few weeks, as people are being careful and deliberative, we'll see where this is going and where this path goes will probably be determined November, December, which is what I think should happen, because the constant making this go on forever tears us apart as a country. And I think we all need to be worried about, you know, one of the things I want to know, and I may never know because this is in a classified setting, is was Russia part of this whole Ukraine deal? Did Putin, there are lots of rumors and I know nothing. Yeah. So let me say that really clear to everybody. I don't know anything.
Right.
But, you know, to this week we've gotten reports of from other intelligence agencies of other countries about how Russia's trying to destabilize democracies in Europe and Western Europe. We know they're trying to do it to us. You know what? We all need to, not Republicans or Democrats, in this country who love our democracy. Our democracy isn't something you take for granted. We have to work to protect it every day. And that's what I'm focused on right now.
Congresswoman Debbie Dingell, thanks so much for coming on tonight. Appreciate it.
Thank you.